this what, 10 years, 15 years now?
15.
15 years. So he's a product programmer. He has learned it under the gurus of product programming.
You included?
Not me. David Warren and Michael Kiefer, so they are all world experts. So that's why I thought best to learn from a guru, not from me. I don't program like he does every day. So he's going to talk only about product. And the theory of product I'm covering in my class, right? Not covering the theory of product, but the underlying principles or first order logic, that's what I'm covering in the class. So I'll do that. So you won't be covering all that. We're just telling you how to program in product, okay? So you'll have one lecture today,
and one lecture on
Thursday, and I think that's good enough for us to do some simple projects in product, okay? And I think you're also going to show them how to download.
Yes, and how to execute it.
Okay. So you'll tell you how to use a system that was developed here over the years. It's called XMP system. I'm going to buy this T-shirt, XMP. So he will tell you how to download that, very easy to download it. Okay, it's open source, available, developed locally in Stony Brook by Professor Warren, right?
Yes.
Okay. All right. So
yes.
Have fun.
Okay, so you will find the lecture notes that we are going to talk about today, including all the examples at this website, www.cs.stonybrook.edu/prologue.pdf. You can either put lowercase prologue or upper capitalized prologue. You will find the slides there. Okay, and I will go over most of them today, and then we'll do more examples on Thursday. So let's start. So today we'll learn about programming in prologue. How many of you programmed in prologue before? No one. Excellent. That's great. Okay, so in prologue, the basic building blocks are what are called relations or predicates. And these relations and predicates are not functions. They are basically building blocks. You have the predicate symbol and the arguments. And as you can see in this example, we have parent of x and y. The meaning that we give to this binary relation is that x is a parent of y. And in a database in Prologue, we can have a set of facts. Who are parents of who else? Like, for instance, Pam is a parent to Bob, Bob to Ann, Tom to Bob, Bob to Pat, Tom to Liz, and so on. So they represent basically a graph that we have parent relationships between the elements here. Some elements, there are also unary relations like female and male, and binary relations and so on. And then we write rules using these predicates. But let's get to the beginning back. So we can have basic predicates like parent, male. And we attach a meaning to these predicates. Like we say that the meaning of parent xy is that x is the parent of y. But within the logical system, they are just simply building blocks. They have no meaning. We can use foo of x and y, meaning that it's x is the parent of y. As long as we are using it consistently in the entire program, it has the meaning that we give it. So they are just the syntactic predicate name followed by the number of arguments in that specific order. Basically, it's a sequence of arguments. The first argument, we give it a meaning, in this case, is that is the parent, and the second argument, that is the child. And we can have many of these predicates. Basically, they can represent data from the real world, that they represent a family relationship. Similarly to that, female X, X is a female, has a meaning, and we have a bunch of facts that represent that specific meaning. And if we want, we can write an entire program that has basically this kind of relationships. And on top of this, we can write rules. So, like in databases and in logic, we can basically write a predicate that is the conclusion of a premise. So, in first order logic, we would write it for all x and y in some domain, like you can consider in the universe or in the domain of people that we have, a set of elements. If X is a parent to Y and X is a female, then we would also like in that database to have that mother of X, Y is true. So in first of the logic, we write it with quantifiers, implication. And then in prologue, we write it with implicit quantifiers and implication from right to left. So basically, in the original rule, we had that if X is a parent of Y and X is a female, we want to infer that for all of such X's, X is a mother to Y. In prologue, we write it as mother X is a mother to Y if X is a parent to Y and X is a female. So there are two things that are implicit here. First, all the variables are universally quantified, and comma in the body of the rule is conjunction. Syntactically, there are other things that we can write in prologue. Basically, semicolon stands for disjunction. We can actually write multiple of these rules, basically, that this predicate is inferred in different ways from the premises. Now, with those predicates, we can write more rules. Like, for instance, here we have a parent relationship that if X is a parent to Z and Z is a parent to Y, then X is a parent to Y. This can be read in two ways. The first way is with the implicit quantifier, universal quantifier outside the rule. So basically, this rule stands for all X and Y. If X is a parent to Z and Z is a parent to Y, then X is a grandparent to Y. But if you basically use logical equivalences, that universal quantifier outside the rule is actually an existential quantifier inside the rule. So the other way to read that rule is that for all X and Y, X is a parent to Y if there is some Z such that X is a parent to Z and Z is a parent to Y. So why is that? In logic, basically, P implies Q is logical equivalent with either Q is true or not P. Now, the variable Z is not used outside the rule in the head. So we could push it inside in the body of the rule. But the body of the rule is with a negation. So universal is outside, negation is on the inner block. If we pass the universal through that negation, it becomes an existential. So really the meaning of that rule, which is equivalent in both ways, but we read it in different ways. The meaning of that rule is that we want to infer for all X and Y that X is a parent to Y if there exists a middle person, Z, such that X is the parent of Z and Z is the parent of Y. But that is logically equivalent with the previous one that we said for all people X, Y, and Z, if X is a parent to Z and Z is a parent to Y, then X is a grandparent to Y.
Professor, shouldn't it be X is a grandparent?
Yes, that's right. Sorry, I actually did that. Grandparent. Thank you. Okay. Any other questions? Okay. And we can continue writing these kind of rules. They are all implications. Another example is if Z is a parent to X and Z is a parent to Y, and X is different than Y, we can infer that X and Y are siblings. So in our graph that we had before, those set of facts, we can ask who are the siblings of N. Or we can ask who are the siblings of everybody. It's like a database. It will return through the internal backtracking all the possible answers, all the siblings of N, or all the siblings of everybody. Bindings that are basically coupled together with the first argument and the second argument. And you can write many such relations. You can write cousins, you can write great-grandparents, great-great-grandparents, and so on. Now, in addition to that, there is also recursion. So we can start thinking about how do we write ancestor. Ancestor is our parents, our grandparents, our great-grandparents, but we don't know how many deep we have in the database. And our program should work on any database, even if there are 1,000 deep, maybe. So then we have to use recursion. So recursively, we can still define, and you can think of induction in discrete math. You can define a relation that is true in a base case, like our parents are our ancestors. So if X is a parent to Y, then X is also an ancestor to Y. Then a recursive rule, like induction, that says if there exists a Z that is an ancestor to Y, and X is a direct parent of Z, then X is also an ancestor to Y. So now these two rules basically give us all the possible levels, no matter if those are 1,000 or 100 or how many they are. So for instance, we can ask who are the ancestors of Jim. We will get first the parents of Jim, because Prolog always starts from the top of the database, tries the first rule, it returns a bunch of answers, and then it tries the second rule. And then it will find people that are parents to some person, and it will try to prove that that person is an ancestor to Jim. So through recursion, it will give us all the ancestors of Jim. We can also ask who are the descendants of Pam, or who are the ancestors of everybody. Now, of course, this is actually dependent on the way that we write the predicates. The fact that first we have the base case, and then we use right recursion, not left recursion. Because if it would be the other way around, then we would actually get into an infinite loop. If we write this predicate right recursive, and we put the recursive rule first before the base case, and we are asking an unbound query like this one, internally, the process, which we'll discuss in a couple of seconds, how Prolog works, will actually go into an infinite loop, because it will try to solve ancestor of XY with ancestor of XZ. But for that, it uses the same rule, and the same rule, and the same rule, and that will basically will never terminate, because we have an infinite branch. So it's true that Prolog, it actually started with a declarative meaning that, oh, we are actually writing things in logic, and we shouldn't care about how they are solved. But that's not actually true, because we have to actually write the programs in such a way that they are not going into infinite loops. Now, the system that we are going to discuss about today, XSV Prolog, has a good feature, which is called tabling, and it has two properties. First, it will actually succeed with all the ancestors without going to an infinite loop in this specific case. So it has better termination features, but it also has better efficiency. Once it computes the answers for a query, it remembers them. It's called tabling or memoization. So it will basically remember those answers without having to query them again and again. So we said we have to understand how Prolog works. Give me a second, I have to mute this microphone here. Excellent. So now this microphone is actually recording, but I'm not going to be double recorded with this other microphone. Okay, so let's return to the original query. Mother XY, if parent XY, and female X. How is this executed? Basically, first we ask a query. Who is the mother of Bob? And it matches that query in a process called also unification with the head of the rules that solve that specific goal. So in this case, it will unify M with X and Bob with Y. And then it will try to solve the body of that rule. So in order to find who is the mother of Bob, I will try to find parents of Bob and those parents to be female. Then it matches the database. So in our case, we have a parent relationship that Bob has two parents, Pam and Tom. It will take the first one in the database. And let's assume that the first one top down in the database is Pam is the mother of Bob. So that will unify M with Pam. And it will ask, is Pam a female? In the database, we also have that Pam is a female. So it will succeed by telling us that Pam is the mother of Bob. In fact, even at that point, we can actually fail explicitly with semicolon and ask who else is a mother, provable mother of Bob. And because there are no more parents of Bob that are female, it will try Tom, but Tom is not a female, and that's the only answer that it finds. Now consider that we have a similar rule for father. A father is a parent that is a male. So again, it will take that rule, it will match it with a query, who is the father of Bob. It will try to solve the body of that rule, that who is a parent of Bob, which is a male. And then the first answer in the database is again, Pam is a parent of Bob. So it will succeed with Pam is a parent of Bob, M is bound to Pam. And then it will ask, is Pam male, which fails. Now, Prolog will backtrack. It will unbind every single assignment that it did. So it will come back here with M unbound, a variable, and it will ask who else is a parent of Bob, and it will succeed with Tom is a parent of Bob, and Tom is a male, and again, it will find an answer. So Prolog execution basically works in this way, and you will see it in the trace when I basically download XSV Prolog, install it on my machine, and then run it. You will see that it calls a predicate. If it finds the answer, it exits with that answer. Otherwise, it fails, and it returns to the caller, basically the previous level. And it will redo that query with the next facts in the database. So this backtracking is actually in the execution of Prolog, which we'll discuss in a couple of minutes. But first, as Professor Ivy Ramakrishnan said, we have to talk about how to actually run programs in Prolog. So you can download the XSV Prolog system from xsv.sourceforge.net. It was developed for the last 25 years at Stony Brook by Professor David Warren and many contributors. In fact, Ivy is the one that implemented the indexing in Prolog with his students, including Professor Shaker. So many other professors in the department worked in either directly in the core Prolog implementation, like Professor Michael Kiefer, or in applications of XSB in model checking, like Professor C. Ramakrishnan. So you should download basically the executable from the Prolog website. Basically, if you go to that website, this is the website, and you will see the latest release of Prolog. If you click on that link, it takes you to this page where if you have a Windows computer, you can basically just install the executable, and it's under C program files XSB. If you have a Linux-based computer, Unix-based computer, you have to build it from sources. Basically, you have to go to the build directory, run configure, and then run make XSB, which will compile all the C core, or it will tell you if it needs to install anything like GCC, but then it will compile everything and you will have an executable in the bin directory. Okay, and that's it. Basically, you either install it with the installer or you change to XSB build, configure, make XSB, and under the bin directory, you have your program. So what do you do next? Like Java, you have to write your program in a text file. And then you need to compile it and load it in Prolog. So first thing, you put your rule set and data in a file with extension .p or .pl. Here I have a simple example. P of x is true if Q of x and any other argument is true. And Q of 1a, Q of 2a, Q of bc are true. Don't forget, all the rules and facts end with a period. So you have to put the period at the end of every line. You want to put comments, you can use like paragraph comments, like in Java, or percent and then line comment. That basically the percent sign acts like the double forward slash in Java or C++. We couldn't use the double forward slash because that's used for integer division. So, okay. Then you type XSB, depending where you have the executable. On Windows, I have it in my environment path variable, and I can run it from any directory. So at this point, you will see a prompt. Now it's ready to type queries. The first query that you will type is the one to compile your program. So in my case, I save my program in myprogram.p, and I compile it with my program. XSB will compile that file. If there are syntax errors in the file, it will complain. Otherwise, you will basically see that it succeeded, and now it's ready to run queries. So you can ask p of x, and it will succeed with x equal 1. If you enter semicolon, that means I want more results. It will tell you that also x of is equal with 2, or x is equal with b, which are basically the answers for this little program that I had before. And similarly, if you are asking p of 1 is true, it will respond yes, it's true. Some useful predicates: if you want to see all the answers at once, you don't want to type semicolons, it's tedious, then you can basically use some predicates like write and new line. And that basically can be used with a fail predicate to show you all the results, which I have in a couple of slides. NL stands for new line. It's a predicate to print a new line. So that is useful in this case. So what this case does, it executes p of x. It writes x equal, and then it writes the value of x. Afterwards, it fails, which will backtrack and try to find more results for p of x. So this will execute as long as there are answers for p of x. The moment that there are no more answers for p of x, it goes on the other branch of this disjunction, which has lower priority than conjunction, and prints true. Basically, it succeeds by actually computing all the answers. So XSB will only return by default the first answer. We can force it with semicolon to give us more answers. And if we don't want that, we can get all the answers either this way or with an aggregate, find all. We'll see it later. There are actually four aggregates: find all, set off, bag off. Like in databases, you don't get automatically removal of duplicates. You have to basically eliminate them manually or use a predicate that does that elimination of duplicates. Any questions up to now? Before we get into the theory of why Prolog works the way that it works, let's actually do exactly what we were teaching before. So as I said, first thing, we need to write our program in a text file. I will use Notepad++. Let's write, this is a.pl. And now I have my editor. Let me increase this font so everybody can see in the back. So let's actually start with the first example that we had. We had the parent relationships. Parent, let's say, Pam to Bob. Also, Tom was a parent to Bob. Then we have parent Bob to Anne. Maybe parent Anne to John. Let's have some siblings there. So also parent Bob to Mary. And maybe some cousins. Parent Mary to John. To Paul. We haven't used Paul. Okay. So now these are facts. We can save the file. We can go to the Prolog interpreter. So I will run it direct from command line. Let's change the directory to the desktop and run XSB. As I said, I have it already in my path for the environment variables. If you don't have it there yet, you can actually see where XSB was installed. SB, you should go to this PC properties, advanced settings, environment variables, path, either here or here, and edit it and see, basically add the new path to XSB. Yes, I have it in documents. I installed it in a different place. Okay. So let's say okay and close it. So at this point, we run XSB in the desktop and we load A. So it compiled fine. We only have facts up of this point, and we can ask who are the parents. Like for instance, parent of XY will succeed with all the parent relationships that we have in the database. We can also ask who are the children of Pam. So because it's a theorem prover, it's not a functional language. You basically don't pass both arguments to get a value. You are asking the system, can you prove anything about parent of XY? Or can you prove anything about parent of Pam X? And it will use matching to find rules that define that specific predicate, find facts, and then succeed only when everything is solved. It does internally something called resolution, and actually an instance of resolution called refutation that tries to prove that if I add the negative fact of this predicate to the database, it makes the database inconsistent, the program inconsistent. So it works internally in a way that we'll see in a couple of seconds. It's basically computing the model for that program. Okay, yeah, go ahead. Okay, excellent question. So anything that starts with uppercase, like X or Stony Brook, is a variable. Anything that starts with lowercase is an atom. So, but that doesn't mean that you cannot make atoms that start with uppercase. You can if you put them within single quotes. Within single quotes, now that is an atom. But again, if you can use any name for variables as long as they start with uppercase. So it basically, this will succeed with telling you that this is the variable and its value, it's Stony Brook. But this is in fact a variable. As long as I didn't assign anything to it, it's a variable. So in the previous case, if I remove the single quotes, now it will tell me that those two variables are the same because I unify them, but neither of them has a value. Like Stony Brook is underscore 160 and this is underscore H160. This is the internal address of that variable. It's basically, as long as it starts with underscore, it means that it's a variable. Any questions? Okay, so now let's write some rules. So we had a couple of rules, family relations. Anyone wants to try one? I don't know you, so you have to announce yourselves. I know Ken. Brother. Okay, excellent. First, let's write the predicate sibling. Sibling of X to Y, if there exists a common father, a parent. Parent Z to X and parent Z to Y. And X is different than Y, because otherwise you would get that Paul is a brother to himself or a sibling of himself, because yeah, he has a common parent and there was nothing to say that X and Y must be different. Okay, so now we have a predicate sibling, so we can write brother X to Y if X is a sibling of Y and X is a male, then X is a brother to Y. If you want a singular relation like Paul is a brother, or we don't care whose brother, then we can add another rule that says This is the broader pole. As long as there exists a Y who X is a sibling of, X is a brother. Don't confuse it with a religious brother. So, okay, save it. So again, first thing we have to do is to load the program. And now it actually tells us that this X here, this Y here is singleton. Okay, so in Prologue, there are no type declarations. In order to do some kind of syntax checking that I didn't mistype some variable, if there are variables that only occur once in a rule, it will succeed compiling the program, but with a warning that that variable in the clause for brother of one is singleton. Maybe I mistyped Y there. It's a warning. And the first thing about Prologue programming style is that you should eliminate warnings. Because if you have warnings, that means that something is ambiguous in the program. So how can we do that? There are the so-called anonymous variables. So what we just did there, we said that I know that this is a singleton variable. I want to basically compile it in such a way that it will not be signaled as a possible error in the program. So I save the program and go ahead. Excellent. We don't have yet data. So let's add male. Who are the males here? Bob, Tom, Paul, and John. And also female, and actually before the, Pam, and Mary. Okay, now we have data. So now we can recompile it and ask brother X to Y. And it says that there are no brothers there. And I think we don't have any brothers in the database. Bob has no siblings. Are there other siblings? Let's see the graph. Pam and Tom are parents to Bob. Bob is a parent to Anne and also to Mary. Anne is a parent to John. In fact, there are no siblings. Okay? No, there are siblings. Mary and Anne, they are siblings. So let's add another sibling. There is a third sibling, Peter. And then Peter is also a male. So now we should get that Peter is a brother to Mary and Anne. So let's return to the program. Peter is a brother to Anne and Mary. Okay. Let's do one more relationship or a few more. Anyone? A family relation. Any? Sister. Sister. X to Y if I have insert sister X to Y if sibling X to Y and female X. Okay, so now sister, X to Y, Anne is a sister to Mary, Anne is a sister to Peter, Mary is a sister to Anne, Mary is a sister to Peter, and that's it. Yeah, go ahead.
Is there a smart way to basically generate the database?
To generate it?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Like these ones or these ones?
I can just say that these are all females, So that if my template is stored somewhere else, I can just directly fetch it from that file from Solo Center or Loop or something like that.
So it's stored where? Excellent. XSB has a CSV library, API, and it has database, JDBC, or ODBC, basically, API. So the facts can be stored in anything you want. In fact, they can be learned from text. Yes. For the other ones on the bottom, there is a direction of prolog logic programming called inductive logic programming. It will basically, you give it a couple of examples of true and false facts which may be inferred from the database, and then it will actually find these rules, like from the facts in the database and possible answers, what are the possible rules that infer these answers. So it's kind of like machine learning. It basically learns the functional dependencies from examples, positive and negative examples. So yes, to both answers. Okay, one more. Uncle. So how do you define uncle? Brother of a parent, excellent. So uncle X to Y, if brother X to some Z, and parent Z to Y. But is that the only people that we call uncles? It's also the husband of an aunt. No, that's also our uncle. Yes, but so it could be that my father has a sister which is married to a guy, and that guy is my uncle too. So it's not a direct sibling. So I can write it uncle X to Y if, okay, we need another relation, husband X to Z, and Z is a sibling or sister of Y, and T, and then T is a parent of Y. That's also an uncle. That's also our uncle. Our aunt's husband is also our uncle. You can consider uncles, yes, all the males. And now we can write ancestor. So, ancestor. Go ahead. X to Y. If direct parent, X to Y. Or. So you can write this kind of like rules to infer the predicate on different ways, either in different rules, like we did here, or you can use this junction in the rule. Now, syntactically, this is just a syntactic sugar. Internally, it gets transformed into these are two ways to compute the answer. So semicolon, it's or parent X to some Z. And parent or ancestor Z to Y. So I don't even need to put parentheses. Like if it makes it easier for you to read, I can put this within parentheses. And then you see that there is a disjunction there. But conjunction has higher priority than disjunction. So even if I leave them like one after another, it's fine. It will be. An ancestor is either a direct parent or a parent of someone that is an ancestor of Y. Okay, so now I can save the program, and I can go here and ask, recompile the program and give me all the ancestors. Or the descendants of Pam. This is one way to run that predicate. And it gives me Bob, Anne, Mary, Peter, and everybody that is a descendant of Pam. Or I can ask, who are the ancestors of John? Ancestor X to John. And then it tells me Anne, Pam, Tom, and so on. Or I can ask, who are the ancestors of everybody? And then it gives me pairs. Ancestor X to Y. And says, Pam is an ancestor of Bob, because it's a direct parent. And Tom of Bob, and all of this. And then it will be two levels, and then three levels, and then four levels. And basically, it returns all the answers in the database. Okay. Any questions? Now, if I have this ancestor as a right recursive relation, so instead of writing it like this, I want an ancestor that X has a descendant Z, and Z is a parent of Y. And I'm asking this first before the direct base case. Bless you. So if I run it like this, oops. Yes, I have a syntax error here. Save this. And I ask ancestor Pam to whom? It will run into an infinite loop. So the reason why is that it basically, okay, I have to stop it now. The reason why, please crash. Okay. The reason why is that it's right recursive. Basically, ancestor of Pam to that variable calls ancestor of Pam to that variable, which calls itself forever. XSB has a feature, as I said earlier, called tabling. So we can actually tell the program table ancestor with two arguments. So now I run the same query as before, and it gives me all the answers. It gives me all the answers and then says, that's it. So this is the feature that is unique to XSB Prolog. It's called memoization of tabling or tabling. Basically, internally, it knows that first time it finds this specific question, it starts a table of answers. Any additional call to that same question, it will now be just a consumer of that producer of answers. The moment that there are no more answers that the producer can produce, it's called answer completion. It finishes completing the answers, and all of the consumers consume those answers. And the program terminates. It also has better efficiency. There are two ways to define this tabling. You can basically say table that predicate that you want, or you can say auto table, which basically now will table all the predicates in the program. You don't need to use this memoization for specific predicates. Any questions? Okay. Excellent question. So this is a notation in Prolog that says ancestor with two arguments. Before I had an example of brother. You see that brother with two arguments and brother with one are different predicates. One that says that X is a brother, the other one that says X is a brother to Y. So when we table, for instance, an example like ancestor, we have to specify the predicate. And which one? The one with two arguments. It's a notation that I believe is adopted also in functional programming, that you specify the function symbol and then the arity of that specific function. Do we have labels? Labels of rules? Yes, but not in XSB. There is a system implemented on top of XSB, Flora, Flora 2, and it has also a commercial version called Ergo. And in that one, you can actually get rule labels. You can basically label the rules. And the reason why is that you want justifications. Why is this an answer? And that will tell you because of this rule with these answers. You can do the same in Prologue, but it doesn't tell you which rules were the ones. So another helpful predicate, which I will add, in fact, I should add it to the lecture notes, is trace. So trace is basically a way to store the to run the program line by line. So for instance, if I ask sibling xy, it will tell me I'm calling sibling of xy, and for that I need to call parent of the second one to the first one, and then it basically executes step by step. It's like debugging in imperative languages. So in this case, it says, I want to compute siblings of xy. For that, I need who is a parent of the first variable. Pam is a parent to Bob. Who else is a parent to the second variable? Also, Pam is a parent to Bob. And then, is Bob different than Bob? No, it's not. And then it tries to redo the previous goal. So it shows you how it executed those queries internally, but it doesn't link them to the rules. It doesn't tell us that rule number 52 was the one that fired. You need to now look in the program and, oh, where is sibling defined? Oh, in this line where it's using parent. And where is parent defined? Oh, in this fact, and so on. So Prologue by default, this is actually part of the standard Prologue tracing, and you can basically see how the Prologue program executed. There are a few good things in this. One is S. S is skip. Basically, let's say that you don't want to go into a predicate. You just want to execute it and get the answer. You can skip. That basically says maybe parent was a complex rule that used other rules. I don't want to go into it. It's like step over in Java. Okay. Then there is leap, which basically says, compute everything. I'm done. I finished the program. And there is also there is leap, there is skip, and there is A for abort. So these are useful flags that you should know in tracing. When you now from now on, the program is tracing. You want to stop the tracing, you say no trace. And now you're basically got in no trace mode.
What is the significance of that yes? Because
ah. Yes. So parent Pam to Bob is yes. And parent Pam to Tom is no.
When you ran that ancestor thing with the table, when we did that.
Before? Oh, I stopped press. So okay, it returned all the answers. So basically, I asked all the answers, all the descendants of Pam. It returned Paul, John, Peter, Mary, and Bob. And I still asked who else. Semicolon is like an explicit fail. Fail and give me more answers. And there were no more people in the that are descendants of Pam. So it is the last answer to ancestor, telling me that this is it. I'm done. Any more questions?
What is
L is leap. L is continue to the end. Abort. Do not continue. Just stop the execution of the current query. So let's see some examples. So let's halt XSB. So halt is to exit XSB. I should probably also add it to the lecture, to the slides. So now I reload A. Let's also don't table so we can actually do more experiments. So, and then ask a query, like for instance, ancestor X. Oh, I can't ask ancestor because it goes into an infinite loop. So let's ask something else, like uncle. uncle X to Y. Ah, I should trace. And then uncle X to Y. And it says uncle call brother. So let's say that I can go into brother and execute it with enter. But I don't want to go, I just want the answer. S will skip it, will directly give me the answer. Peter is a brother to N. Now it continues. Let's say that I don't want to continue, I just want to abort. Now I know where the error is. A aborts. Now let's rerun the query. Uncle, oh, let's trace first. And then rerun the query. And here, let's say I'm at sibling, I'm done. I know that where the error is, L will continue the execution, stop the debugging. It's like execute the rest. And no trace. Okay. Any questions? Good. Let's get into lists, a little bit more complicated stuff. But before that, let's do a little bit of theory of why this works, why Prolog works, and what is it based on. It's declarative because basically we write kind of facts and rule inference rules, and then it computes the answers. We don't actually tell it how to do it, but internally there is a methodology to do it. So in logic, you can write statements in different ways in first order logic. You with quantifiers inside the body, and with multiple implications and so on. And the whole idea is that you want to have an automatic theorem prover. But if you are using pure logic, that's great for people. They can write very complex formulas. And there was a project in which I worked many years ago in which you would write a formula in pure first order logic. But then it's completely useless, because no one would actually be able to use it in a theorem prover. And that was exactly what we found out. We basically wrote an entire textbook of biology in logic formulas because we were told to do so, but then they didn't do anything with it because there is no prover that takes first order logic with quantifiers and just uses them. So it turns out that in order to make this, to have decidability and also for the program to actually be proved mechanically, you must have statements in a certain way, which are called Horn clauses. They were named after Alfred Horn, who first pointed their significance in 1951. And that's what logic programming systems do. They write all the rules into a certain form. Basically, you have a body that is implies a head. The body may use conjunction, disjunction, negation, and you have a single implication. All the quantifiers are universal quantifiers implicit outside the rule, so you don't explicitly say any quantifier. And the statements will be of two kinds, axioms or facts, which are considered true, and theorems, which define what is provable true. If the body of that theorem is true, the premise is true, then the conclusion is also true. And then you have goals, which basically are things that you would like to be proven true, and the system will succeed with binding the variables to those values. So a Prolog program, and in fact many programs in this spectrum, is basically a sequence of clauses. Each clause, also called a rule or a Horn rule, is of this form. A head, which is a single term, and a body, which is a comma-separated list of terms. It basically means a conjunction of the terms in the body. You can have a head without a body, in which case you omit writing if and the body, and that's called a fact. Basically, we know for sure that this is true, no matter what, if it's true, it's defined that it's true. So the Prolog is basically a database. It contains facts like raining in New York, raining in Seattle, and rules, which have both sides, clauses with both sides. Like if it's raining in X, then it's wet in X. The conjunction of the terms in the body implies the head of that rule. Now, the variables in Prolog are called single assignment variables. If you bind the variable in the body to some value, all the occurrences of that variable in the rule must have that value. It's a conjunction. So basically, in the body of that rule, you have a conjunction. And for all of those, the variable must be the same. So if you have, you want to say that there is a body that is brown and is square or rectangle, then you write square x and x is brown. Okay. So Prolog will actually respond to queries. Is basically a goal-directed theorem prover. You are asking the query, is it wet in x? And it will try to prove it with the facts in the rule. Let's see how. So the rules allow you to have variables. For instance, in order to have more interesting rules, we may have that, for instance, x is employed if there exists a y such that it employs x. So we read this in English as for all x, x is employed if there exists a y such that y employs x. And earlier we said that we can also read it for all x and y if y implies x, then x is employed. But this is closer to how this rule is written. Basically, it shows us that the variables outside, the variables in the head are universally quantified outside the rule. And then you have an existential quantifier for those variables that occur for the first time inside the rule. This also, notice the direction of this implication. It doesn't say that x is employed only if there exists a y that employs him. There might be other ways of employing people. Like some people we are told that they are employed, but we don't know who employs them. Like Bill is employed, but we don't know who is his employer. Or maybe x is self-employed, he has a startup, and this is a different rule. There is no boss of x. If x is self-employed, then x is employed. So really, that colon dash means if, and that's it. It's not only if. There are many other ways to infer that the fact in the head is true. Any questions? OK. So the scope of the variable is given by the position in the clause. The variables that occur for the first time in the head, they are implicitly universal quantifiers outside the head. Like for all x, we will infer that those x are employed if the body is true. The variables whose first appearance is in the body of that clause are existentially quantified inside that body. So existentially quantified means that if there exists a y that employs x, then x is employed. And this is for every x. Now, notice that through logical equivalences, that existential quantifier in the body becomes universal quantifier outside the body. I will not go into basically why is that. It's a simple logical equivalence because of negation of the body that basically becomes a universal outside the body. But believe me, that's the case. If you don't believe me, just come to me after the class and we do the logical equivalence. And this is another example. A grandmother can be written as a mother of a mother of C. But probably we would like to add another rule that says also I have the paternal grandmother, which is the mother of the father of C. So I will get grandmothers from the first rule, or one grandmother from the first rule and one grandmother from the second rule. Any questions? OK. So now we get back to transitive closure. So if we have a graph, we can represent it as a set of facts. There is an edge from 1 to 2, from 2 to 3, from 2 to 4, and so on. And then we can write transitivity. And this cannot be written in first order logic. Because in first order logic, you would get models which are with other things that are not in the minimum set. First order logic does not compute least models. It doesn't compute minimal models. It computes all the models that in which these two implications are true. And in logic, false implies anything is true. So you would get models in which you don't have everything, like you don't have only reachability. You have reachability and other things, because false implies anything. So you can have from false that there is a reachability that you didn't have in the graph. So that's where we basically have the difference between logic programming that computes minimum models, and in most cases they are the intended models by the programmer, and only those models. And we have first of the logic, which is a little bit more ambiguous, different. So here we have two rules. The first rule says if there is an edge from x to y, then we can reach from x to y. The second rule says that if there is an edge from x to z, to some z, and z is there is reachability from z to y, then I can also reach from x to y. So if I ask a query in this graph, the graph that I had before, what nodes can be reached from what nodes, it gives me all the reachabilities, all the edges, 1, 2, 2, 3, 2, 4, and it also gives me 1, 2, 3, and 1, 2, 4. And that's all. There are no more answers. If I have a cycle, it will give me answers forever. So that's where tabling comes into play. Okay. So we will now explore more about the terms. Until now, you just believe me that anything that is capitalized is a variable. And lowercase things are constants. And there are also numbers, as we saw in the previous example. So we'll talk about the syntax of Prolog programs. Terms can be atomic data, which includes symbols like A, B, and so on. PAM, TOM. It also includes numbers, like integers and reals. You don't need to define these numbers. Basically, they are recognized like in Python. But this was invented about 30 years before Python. Then you have variables, capitalized strings that basically are variables. You don't have to declare their type. And then you have structures. So we start with atomic data. So anything that you have in programming languages like C, Java, Python, like numeric constants, integers, 1024, minus 42, or floating point numbers, reals, like 3.1415, 6, period 0, 2, 3, exponent 23. Those are all recognized as numbers and they are used as numbers. Then you have atoms, which are basically symbols internally. They are sequences of letters and digits and underscore beginning with a lowercase letter, like pol, r2d2, 1 underscore element. Strings within single quotes, like Stony Brook, even if they contain spaces, they are recognized as atoms. It's like symbolic processing. You can basically use them for defining either predicate names or the atoms within the predicates as terms, as arguments. Then you have variables. A variable is any identifier that begins with uppercase letter or underscore, like for instance, x, index, underscore param. These are all single assignment logical variables. They can be assigned a value only once. The different occurrence of the same variable in the clause denotes the same data. They are implicitly declared upon their first use. You don't have need to type them. In fact, Prolog is probably one of the weakest typed languages. It automatically infers all the types, and there are only those that we enumerated. Numbers, atoms, and then you have structures. And that's it. It's actually the simplest language to learn and the hardest language that exists. And why do I say it's the hardest? Because in imperative programming, you execute the program forward, like from the top of the method to sequentially to the bottom. Prolog has backtracking. So you execute forward and then fails and then backtracks. And it's not only like you're just forward and backward. No, it's forward, backward, forward, backward again, forward, backward. It's a tree. So, in my opinion, it's exponentially harder than imperative programming. Unless you look at it as a database. Because the moment that you filter out the execution of Prolog, you just think of it as declarative programming, you're writing logical formulas. And you're not interested in one answer at a time, you're interested in all the answers. And then you can consider that what we had before, like for instance, these examples, these are just joins. It says, join husband on the second argument with sibling, and then join sibling with parent, and you get the table of all the uncles. So now you look at it as a database, and these are just joins to give you an inferred database table. Okay? And that's much easier. That in that moment, that's probably the moment that you say, I now understand. Now it's basically just queries in the database. But you always have to remember that there is a backtracking going on. So yes, you try to forget that there is this procedural execution, but if you don't want to get into infinite loops, then you have to think how to write these joins in an efficient way. Besides the fact that you also have to care about indexing. By default, Prolog only indexes on the first argument or starting from the beginning. So if you query this predicate with the second argument bound, like who are the ancestors of Jim, you can already see that this is very inefficient because it starts with a variable, finds all the descendants of that variable, and then it asks, is that also parent of Jim? So if you write your predicate badly, like this one that I wrote, it's bad. I mean, yes, it's declarative, and it will give me all the correct answers if I use tabling, but it will compute all the ancestors of everybody in the database. So don't write ancestors the way I did it. Look in the lecture's notes. Okay, now, if a variable doesn't start with underscore, it's assumed to appear multiple times in the rule. If it doesn't appear multiple times, then a warning is produced singleton variable, like we saw in the case of sibling. You can use variables preceded with underscore to eliminate this warning. These are called anonymous variables or don't care variables. So, and they are used for eliminating warnings, because warnings are good. They are good for identifying bugs, mostly because of copy-paste errors and mistyping of names. Instead of using declarations and to make programming simpler and without types, basically Prolog uses warnings to warn the programmer that they may have made a mistake at compile time. So if we do have variables that we only use once in a rule, we have to precede them with underscore and eliminate all such warnings. These are, as I said, anonymous or don't care variables. They start with underscore and they represent basically any variable. Underscore by itself is a variable, so I can declare a predicate has a child X if X is a parent of that underscore. Each occurrence of underscore corresponds to a different variable, even within the same clause. So if I want, I can define somebody has a child in my database if parent of underscore underscore succeeds. Now, if this would have a real name like parent of XX, that's false. There is no parent of himself. But underscore underscore will be two different values. So this will succeed and it will tell me that yes, in the database somebody has a parent. So you can actually continue with letters after the underscore, like underscore radius, underscore size, to basically give a descriptive name to that named variable. And also, if you have an underscore with a name, then if it occurs multiple times in a rule, that's fine. It will not be a warning. It's basically defining a relationship, but we don't need the value in the head of the rule. So it will just return those values. Now, internally, Prolog binds these variables with their values. So it's not assignment. Remember the fact that this is basically like you can think of them as pointers to locations in memory. So you can say that X is pointed to a location that contains the functor F of Y. Y is G of Z, and Z is 2. This will succeed with X is F of G of 2, Y is G of 2, and Z is 2. And the order doesn't matter. Basically, conjunction is commutative. So I can actually say that 2 is bound to Z, Z is 2. X is bound to F of Y, and Y is bound to G of Z, which is actually just shuffling the things above, and it succeeds with the same thing. X is F of G of 2, Y is G of 2, and Z is 2. Even infinite structures. You can ask a query, is X equal with F of X? It succeeds, and actually now you can replace X with F of X, because X is F of X, so X is also F of X. You can replace X with F of X, and you get that X is F of X, and this continues to infinity. It will succeed and tell you that X is infinite application of F on itself. Any questions? It's useful in some cases when you have a variable at the end of, let's say, a list, and you want to create a circular list. Okay, any questions up to now? Okay, and we talked about querying earlier. Basically that if you ask a query, if it can prove it, it will respond yes. If it cannot, it says no. If it contains variables, the interpreter will give you values. So wet of New York, it will respond yes, if that can be inferred in the data. Wet of X, it will return X is New York or X is Seattle and nothing else. You can ask if we can reach D from A, or we can reach what can from what nodes we can reach D. And these are all answers that will be responded from the corresponding programs. Which brings us to the semantics of Prolog. So I want to tell you what is the semantics of Prolog, and then next lecture we do lists. So we start with semantics of Prolog. So Prolog has the semantics defined in two ways. The declarative meaning, which is the logic consequences of the program, is the what are the logical consequences of this set of first order rules. And the procedural meaning, for what values of the variables of a query I can prove that query. In this procedural meaning, we give a goal to Prolog. Prolog will attempt to find axioms and inference rules to prove that goal. If the goal also contains variables, it will give us values for those variables. So in just one slide, I will tell you what's the declarative semantics. In first order logic, with closed word assumption, basically the idea that these are all the things that we know and nothing else is in the world, the declarative meaning is the set of the logical consequences of the program, which in logic programming is the smallest set such that all the facts in the program are in that set. And for every rule in the program that the head is implied by the conjunction in the body, B1 to Bn, if that is an instance clause in the program such that B1 to Bn are all in the logical consequences, then H is also in the logical consequences. So let's look at this program. We have that a bear is brown, a bear is also big, an elephant is gray, an elephant is big, a cat is black, a cat is small, and then Z is a dark thing if it's black, or Z is a dark thing if it's brown, and X is dangerous if it's dark and big. So from this program, the logical consequences is the set of all the facts, plus from the fact that a cat is black, that the cat is dark, plus from the fact that a bear is brown, that a bear is dark, plus the fact that if a bear is brown, is dark and big, it's dangerous. So from that above program, we get the logical consequences of the program, the set of facts, union, dark cat, dark bear, and dangerous bear. This is the model theoretic semantics. Basically, it says, what is the minimum fixed point of this program? If you consider the facts to be true, and now it's basically the set of facts that are supported. If basically they are true, if the premises of the rules are true, then the consequences are also true. That's the logical declarative meaning. And now, the procedural meaning. We ask a query to the system. A query is a conjunction of goals, like G1, G2, up to Gn. In order to prove that G1 to Gn is true, G1 and G2 and up to Gn, we want to find a clause such that the goal G1 matches the head of that clause. This order is in the order of prologue. Prologue looks from left to right to prove basically the goals. It also looks in the rules from top to bottom. So it will find the first rule that matches the first goal. Instead of proving that goal, it will replace the goal G1 with the body of that rule. So if G1 and H match, they match under substitutions for variables, basically unifications of variables to values. And then it will ask a new goal B1 to BK, G2 to GN. And we'll try to prove that goal. When does it end? When these clauses have an empty body, facts. Because in that case, the goal is replaced by nothing. The moment that we reach nothing, basically, we have nothing left to prove, then the proof succeeds. If there are no more clauses to match, then the proof fails. So let's see an example. We ask a query dangerous of Q. Q is dangerous. There is a single rule that has the head dangerous. And that is dangerous X if X is dark or big. So basically, the query dangerous Q is replaced by dark Q, big Q. And now the first thing that it finds in the database for dark is the predicate that says something is dark if it's black, which will now try to prove, will replace dark Q with black Q and big Q, which now succeeds for black cat. So it will try to prove big cat, but there are only two facts in the database, big bear and big elephant, which do not match with cat. So that proof fails. We go back to step two and we find another rule for dark, that something that is brown is dark. And now we are asking the query, what is brown and big? And a bear is brown, and the bear is big, so there is nothing left to prove, and the proof succeeds. So this is what I said about a tree, that we ask the query, it tries to prove one branch, then it backtracks and finds another answer on another branch. And there is an order to this. This was tried first, and then it tries the other branch. Okay? Any questions? So the prologue interpreter works in what is called backward chaining, also called top-down resolution or goal-directed. It begins with the thing that it tries to prove, and then that is based on other things. It tries to prove those. It uses a stack of all of these goals. It takes always the top of the stack to prove it. There is an alternative to do bottom-up resolution, which basically is adopted by other programming systems like DLV and Klingo and OntoBroker. The idea there is that from the facts that we have and the rules that we have, we want to compute what else is true. So basically, it goes backward from the facts. It proves everything in the world. The only problem is that if you have functor symbols, and lists are actually an example of functor symbols, your models are not finite. So usually these languages do not have functor symbols. Because think of the following case. In our program, we have P of 1 is true, and then P of F of X is true if P of X is true. Now, this program will work fine if I ask a query like, is P of F of F of 1 true? It will respond after three steps, that yes, it's true. But if I want to compute the entire model of this program, it's infinite. P of 1 is true, P of f of 1 is true, P of f of 1 is true, P of f of f of f of 1 is true, and so on to infinity. So systems like DLV and Klingo do not have function symbols. And they are useful for a programming language. Otherwise, you can't implement arrays or lists. So the prologue interpreter does exactly what I described earlier. Keeps a stack of all the goals and executes the goals from the left-hand side to the right-hand side one by one and uses that stack. And this is based on resolution, which will be taught by Professor Ivy Maramakrishnan, I believe, tomorrow. It's due to Robinson in 1965. It says that if there are two clauses and those two clauses are disjunctions, these rules that we wrote in prologue, they can be written as disjunctive rules. And the rule contains a predicate and its negation, then the disjunction from the rest of those two rules is also a consequence of the program. So resolution is a theorem prover system that basically has only two rules. One says that every fact in the program is true, and the second one applies this resolution principle that Professor Ivy will teach tomorrow. And with that is proven to be complete and sound and complete with respect to proving inconsistency of queries. So basically, it shows that if you are adding the negation of the query of the goal to the program, you reach an inconsistent state. Therefore, the predicate must have been true. So I will stop here. Basically, I only want to finish this slide. Prologue is not purely declarative because it uses the order of the database and the left to right pursuit of goals. Now, if the queries are executed basically in a breadth-first search, then you will reach the answers in finite time. But because of the fact that it goes depth first search and it considers the order of rules in the program, it may go into an infinite branch and will never reach an answer, even if it's in the next step on a different branch. Okay? And this is the example that we had earlier. Infinite loop, doesn't matter what edges are in the database, they will never be used. That's all for today. See you next class. Thank you.